You make me laugh. What he does, nothing can make me say. I like Beethoven's symphonies.
Thank you. Thank you. life goes on. Oh, la la la, the life goes on.
But a little bare. Let's get the violas in there. Now, cellos and basses, in you go. It's time to add the continuo.
This is a stick-up. Line up over there. The next guy that moves gets the same treatment.
I see the rich, I see the poor, I see the in-between. I see both monks and soldiers here, I see the king and queen. But a sober soul going out that door is something I have never ever seen. In fact, even I've been known to take a nip. For after all, the captain has to go down with the ship. Hip, hip, hooray for all my customers, a motley lot they be. They serve their lord and masters on the land and on the sea. They also serve who only stand and wait on tables like me.
The text of a piece called Classical Rap. Now, it's true that I did make some changes in the spoken part.
Hello? No, no, you're not catching me in the bathroom. No, no. Oh, really? Okay, guys, we can do it. Yeah, okay. No, that's great. Thank you. No, thank you so much. Thank you.
ready to get there.
On your mark, get set, go!
Good evening, music fans. Here we are at Philharmonic Hall in New York Mills, Minnesota. It's a beautiful night for a concert. There's not a cloud in the ceiling. And there's quite a crowd out here. About how many do you think there are, Bob?
Oh, I don't know, Pete.
Well, neither do I, but it's quite a crowd. And I think they're looking forward to hearing the New York Mills Philharmonic playing against the Danish conductor, Heilige Dankesang. And here he comes now, ascending the podium. And the players are all lined up and ready to begin the first inning of Beethoven's Symphony No. 5 in C minor. And they're off with a four-note theme. This is very exciting. The beginning of a symphony is always very exciting, folks. I don't know whether it's slow or fast yet because it keeps stopping. It doesn't seem to be able to get off the ground yet. And it looks like, yes, it looks like we're coming up to a cadence here, folks. The violins didn't cut off there. A little trouble with the violins. They weren't watching. And there's that four-note theme again, folks. And another stop. Just can't seem to get this piece off the ground. Now it seems to be rolling a little bit. Seems to be building up. Tell me, Bob, do you think you'd call that four-note idea a theme or a motif?
Well, Pete, the technical term would be motif, which he uses to build a theme.
I see. Thanks for setting me straight about that, Bob. Well, we're heading into the second theme section here, and we can expect a little modulation down there. Wow, did you hear that, Bob? Somebody down there in the horn section really flubbed that note. That was one of the worst fumbles I think I've ever witnessed in all my days. I think it was number one, wasn't it, Bob?
Yes, it was, Pete. That was Bobby Corno in the first chair, and that's the third major flub he's made this season, giving him a solo average for the season of approximately .247355, which is pretty darn low for a first chair man.
You think there's some chance he might be sold to another orchestra?
Well, it's hard to say, Pete. Corno's very good in the long solos, things like the Rachmaninoff Piano Concerto. So I think if he pulls himself together a bit, they'll probably keep him around, although I suppose he might...
Well, I think it's development time down there now, Bob. Let's see what's going to happen. The horns are starting it off. They seem to be in pretty good shape now, and I get the feeling that we're probably going to be hearing a lot of that four-note motif, don't you, Bob?
Yes, I do, Pete.
So do I, Bob. Well, they obviously are stuck with that four-note motif, and they're going to be fooling around with it for quite a while. You notice it's pretty hot in here, Bob?
Yes, I do, Pete.
Yeah, I think the air conditioning has gone off, which is one of the things... Wait a minute, there's something going on down there on the stage, folks. There's something happening down there. It's really building up tension. The crowd is getting very excited. The brasses have come in, and the timpani, and everybody, and it's extremely exciting. I think we're building up to a fugue. No, the basses are not picking up the theme, folks. It is not a fugue. The violins tried to make it one, but the basses are not following up. No, instead of a fugue, folks, he seems to be taking the theme and breaking it up into little pieces. Just two notes left of that theme now being thrown around from player to player. And it's getting softer and softer down there, folks. I think they're losing steam. They seem to be running out of steam. And it's just getting a little bit lethargic down there, if you want to know the truth. It's gotten down to one note now. And things are... Wait a minute! The brasses have come in and tried to pep things up. A welcome relief. But I'm afraid to no avail. Things are still pretty somber. Wait a minute. They hear they come again. They're really determined. It sounds very familiar. And I think we've reached the recap, Bob, don't you?
There's no doubt about it, Pete. Your average Beethoven symphony usually has a recap right after the second quarter, and this one is falling right into line.
Well, let's see if those violins can cut off with the rest of the orchestra, and the cadence is coming up. Wait a minute. This time it's the oboe holding the note too long. Wait, he's playing a cadenza. He must be out of his mind. He thinks it's an oboe concerto. The conductor's standing down there. He doesn't know what to do. Have you ever heard anything like that, Bob?
I certainly haven't, Pete. I think it was a disgraceful display of lack of teamsmanship. I wouldn't be at all surprised if Highwood's name wasn't on the roster next season, although I must say that the fans really seem to go for these outbursts of temperament.
Well, I always say, Bob, professional music teams wouldn't exist without the spectators. Anyway, we're into the home stretch here with the second theme coming up, and we should be in C minor right up to the double bar. Wait a minute. That's really something, Bob. The piece's build is being in C minor, and yet it looks like it's going to end in C major.
It's really something, Pete.
Well, I think it's something that the Composers Commission ought to look into, and I suspect that they will as soon as this gets out. But it looks like it's going to be an ending anyway. Things are building up a little there. The violins have really gotten a hold of things. They're really beginning to roll. And now he's adding all the woodwinds there. He's thrown in all his brass and the timpani. And it's tutti all the way, folks. on his hands here, and he looks like he's really coming into the home stretch. Well, I guess that about wraps it up, eh, Bob?
Yeah, Pete, it's been a good piece.
I think he can really have something to be proud of himself here. Wait a minute! The Brasses are taking the theme! They're not letting it stop! They're taking the theme and running ahead! Bob, this piece is definitely going to go into overtime. I can see that. The crowd is going wild. They're standing up on their feet. They're jumping. They're stomping. They're yelling. And let me tell you that down on that stage, the players are doing a bit of running around themselves. Nobody, but nobody knows where the theme is. The audience, nor the players, nobody knows where that theme is. Everybody is running around, and believe me, it's very exciting. This is the kind of thing that only happens once in 10 years, folks. They've got a new theme going on down there. I can't believe it. Bob, do you know where this new theme comes from?
Well, Pete, it probably comes from, No, I don't, Pete.
Well, they're tossing it around now. The woodwinds have it, and then the strings have it. Nobody seems to be able to keep his hands on that theme. It's getting tossed around from player to player, from section to section. And believe me, folks, the audience is just as confused as the players is about who is going to have that theme finally.
Excuse me, folks. We seem to have the tape on backwards or something. Give it another try.
Wait a minute. The strings have got a hold of it. The strings have got a hold of that theme, and they are not going to let go. What's this? I can't believe my ears. It sounds as if it's another recap. It sounds as if he's going right back to the beginning. If this is true, it's the first time it's happened in 10 years of concert casting. Wait a minute. Those sound like final chords, though. This may be... That may be it, folks. I'm looking down at the referee. Yes, yes, that is it. That is the end of the piece. The players are taking off their helmets, and the conductor has turned around and is acknowledging the cheers of the crowd. Well, it was quite a symphony, wasn't it, Bob?
It was quite a symphony, Pete, and I think the fans feel that they got their money's worth.
So do I, Bob. And I don't think there's any doubt about who won this contest, either. As a matter of fact, I wouldn't be surprised if the critics slap a stiff penalty on some of the players, particularly Bobby Corno.
Neither would I, Pete. And, of course, this was a very important victory for Haile Gadankazong, since it puts him right up there at the top of the conductor's league.
That's right, Bob. That means that he'll be up against the Fargo-Moorhead Symphony in the World 12-Tone Series next month. And let's see, they not only lead the orchestral league, but I think they're unbeaten this season, aren't they, Bob?
You said it, Pete, and if Gadankazong can win four concerts off them, he'll be the first conductor to earn the pennant since Toscanini.
Well, that's quite a challenge, Bob. Now I think I'd better be heading down to the locker rooms to have a chat with Gadankazong himself.
Well, Pete, I think he was supposed to be doing a baton commercial after the concert, but why didn't you give it a try?
I'll do that, Bob. So for now, this is Pete Shickley.
And Bob Dennis.
Signing off for the wonderful wide world of notes. We'll be right back.
Russia.
Pump up the bass!
Okay, what's next?
Well, I guess that's about all. But what is this
about a radio talk show called Zapped by Zend? Now, come on, put this on. Let me hear it.
If you insist.
Hello, America, and welcome to Zapped by Zend, the program that ferrets out phonies and then stomps on them till they're nothing but a pathetic puddle of putrid. We've got Daryl on the line. Hi, Daryl. You're on the air.
Hi, Howie. I have a friend who's got a lot of albums of the music of P.D.Q. Bach, and I can't find that name in any music dictionary.
The reason you can't find P.D.Q. Bach in the music dictionaries is that he doesn't exist.
Here we go.
And he never has existed,
right,
except in the febrile imagination of the self-styled Professor Peter Schickley, who's one of the sleaziest phonies ever to crawl out of the swamps of academe. You don't have to take my word for it. The whole thing is a parody of Johann Sebastian Bach. Is a hoax, a juvenile scam that has made dupes out of untold numbers of record buyers. Daryl, I want you to listen to this recording that blows the lid off PDQ Bach. You are about to be zapped by Zend.
A lot of people have said that I actually made PDQ up, and that's a scurrilous lie. Just because there's no direct evidence of something doesn't mean it doesn't exist. So sometimes you just have to take things on faith, like the Tooth Fairy and the Easter Bunny. Anyway, PDQ Bach certainly did exist, as far as I'm concerned, and he liked to write poems. The mule he has two legs behind and two he has before. We stand behind before we find what the two behind before. Very old poem.
Fanfare for the Common Cold, Concerto for Two Pianos versus Orchestra, Music for an Awful Lot of Winds and Percussion.
My favorite P.D.Q. Bach discovery is the short-tempered clavier.
And Einstein on the Fritz is one of my particular favorites. These subversive-sounding titles could only be the work of classical music's most popular satirist, Peter Schickley, a prolific and versatile composer who is possessed from time to time by his best-known creation and alter ego, P.D.Q. Bach. I wondered if there was some way you could illustrate how you hear a piece of music and think this would be great for a satire.
Well, in the first place, what is perhaps worth saying is that when people say, do you do P.D.Q. Bach in order to bring people into classical music, to me that's a wonderful side product. But I think that any entertainer is probably lying if he says that the reason he does something is for educational reasons. My mother says I've been entertaining people since I was 18 months old. I told that to one of my friends, and she said, what took you so long? So I think basically the urge to entertain and to see the funny side of something is, for me, a basic one. And even though I've written a lot of serious music in addition to all the P.D.Q. Bach stuff, I always have that tendency to see the funny side of something. The secret ingredient of P.D.Q. Bach is that it isn't exactly a replica of Bach or Mozart or whoever it's sending up at the time.
It's, for want of a better word, a little twisted.
Yes, right. It actually has its own sort of language, and what you strive for in something like that is to make it fun to listen to more than once, even after you know what the gags are.
With such an ear for the way other people create music, was it a struggle at all to sort of make your way through the musical thicket to what your own sound was, your own style?
I've always felt that you do that in time, and I'm not saying I never thought about it or worried about it, but I've sometimes thought that this century has such a high priority on individuality that young composers worry about it too much. In other words, I remember when I was a composition student at Juilliard, to tell somebody that his quartet sounded Shostakovich or something was terrible. Nobody wanted to hear that. And yet I think in the 18th century, you just wrote music. And if you had an individual personality, it came out as you matured. But you didn't worry about finding your own voice so much as early as possible. So it's true that I have a chameleon-like quality. And even in my serious music, it ranges from serious, really serious with a capital S, sad, whatever you want to. But also a lot of my serious pieces have real sort of fun places in them. But it's always bothered me that people accept the idea of a novel or a play or a movie that is basically serious having comic scenes in it. But in music, they seem to say this is either a serious piece or a funny piece. period, nothing in between. That's just not the way I think.
Pardon me, you may think I'm wrong about this, but it seems to me that music, more than any art form, is obsessed with categorizing. Maybe it's because they have to figure out where to put the record in the record bins or something, but there seem to be more ways to split music apart than any other art form.
And it's certainly something that annoys me, the whole record bin thing, and then also it's interesting that radio stations are very sensitive about their formats. I do a radio program of my own called Shickley Mix, and part of the point of the program is to illustrate musical principles with all different kinds of music, and a lot of stations have trouble with it because if they're a classical station, they don't want somebody turning in the middle of the program and hearing Conway Twitty or the Beatles or something. And it's interesting to me in that we live in a time when multicultural is one of the buzzwords, and yet a lot of radio stations are extremely worried about putting on anything that doesn't fit into their format, which is another aspect of what you're saying. The business of a composer working in a lot of different ways, I don't think is anything new, actually. If Mozart were writing now, I'm sure he'd be writing film scores.
How did we get in the pickle that we're in then? If the composers, the Mozarts of the world, had this great sort of elasticity about what they did, how did we get to be so ossified and so rigid?
My own theory is that something that started in the 19th century and really came to fruition in this century was the artist against society and this feeling of course the common people aren't going to like what I do, I'm way ahead of my time, and the sense of not caring about what somebody thought about the music other than other composers.
I want to return to a night in 1965. Talk about taking risks and playing to different audiences. When you unleashed P.D.Q. Bach on the world at large.
I think you have to remember 1965 was the advent of the LP. They started recording everything. The complete Vivaldi, the complete Haydn, complete Bach cantatas, the complete, you know, and a lot of people were really ready for something that made fun of Baroque and 18th century music.
It was a wonderful moment. I mean, the setup was perfect.
I think that's one of those things, you don't time it. You just do what you do, but in retrospect, the timing seems perfect for a takeoff on 18th century music.
Hello and welcome to Zapped by Zend. My name's easy to spell. Z for zealot and proud of it. E for ever vigilant. Don't you forget it. N for never napping. So don't try to pull anything. And determined to keep this country great. Z-E-N-D, Zend. You are about to be Zapped by Zend.
Yes, this is Max himself, first film comedian to be known by name.
No, thank you. Stop that! Come on! No, really, I don't have time!
With Max, film comedy passed from primitive horseplay to polite farce.